And thank you, audience, for staying with us. I would like to take a different tack, but may discuss some aspects that have already been talked about previously now. When you do eccentric exercise, and I do that now, I will just quickly go to the fact that knowing that we are in an exercise physiology environment, we don't need necessarily to talk about what is concentric and eccentric, but for the sake of clarity, I still want to do it. So concentric exercise means that your muscle contracts, i.e. that the sarcomere that you see here shortens during activation, so you do positive work or you accelerate. And the way you do that, the mechanism, is the myosin ATPase. Whereas when you do negative work during muscle activation, the distance between the C lines of the sarcomere get longer. So you do negative work, which means you decelerate, and so the muscle lengthens during the time it is active. It is actually the same muscle that does it. With regard to the mechanisms, this is not entirely clear what the mechanism is. As I said, for concentric contractions, it's the classical view of the actin-myosin system. It is believed that maybe titin, the third filament, may play a role in it, and it has been shown by the group of Walter Herzog at Calgary that in some specific condition on single fibers, the myosin ATPase system can be ruled out in terms of providing the tension that the single muscle fibers do produce. But it is currently unclear how eccentric tension in a muscle is produced, which is, by the way, quite interesting. Eccentric exercise has three unique properties that may be used in rehabilitation. Eccentric exercise can produce very high torques. Eccentric exercise has low metabolic requirements, and eccentric exercise is a challenge for coordination. And I will go through these points independently, and I will then try to show you how these properties of eccentric exercise can be exploited in rehabilitation or in training. The fact that you can produce high torque in eccentric exercise, you can see here. In a concentric exercise, we have a Hill relationship, meaning that the torque or the tension the muscle produces decreases with increasing speed of contraction. When you do an eccentric contraction, the force or the torque first increases and then stays constant, doesn't decrease anymore. And that has an important implication in terms of the power that the muscle can produce. This power is obviously the physics tells you that the power is torque times angular velocity. That's just the formula. That for any angular velocity that is zero, of course, power must be zero. And I've plotted in here the power curve, which has an optimum, maybe around 200 degrees per second angular velocity, and then drops off again. And this is not the case in eccentric contraction, because in eccentric contractions, the negative power produced increases first here, as you can see, with angular velocity increasing, but then because torque stays up, power increases indefinitely. So there is no limit to the amount of power you can produce. If you make a drop jump from 10 meters, you actually destroy yourself, because that is the ultimate eccentric exercise. So, low metabolic requirements. And this has been shown nicely for the first time by Pickle and Ritchie in 1952 by having two ergometers set up back to back and measuring, as you can see here, oxygen consumption with the Douglas bag system. In general, we see that the energy requirement of eccentric exercise are about 1/4 of the energy requirements of concentric exercise. So it's 25%. If you do eccentric exercise and you produce 100 watts of negative power to the machine, then your oxygen consumption is equivalent to what you would do in 25 watts concentric exercise. So it takes it down to 1/4. So as I said, the difference is approximately 4-fold. Now to the point of difficult coordination, and this refers again to the review paper of Bickle and Ritchie, indicating that when you look at the integrated EMG, the integrated EMG shows that for a particular work rate or tension produced by the muscle, you only need half the integrated EMG, which effectively says that the gradation with which you control the intensity of your exercise is much coarser when you do eccentric exercise. It's much more difficult to control eccentric exercise because the gradation with which you can access your motor pool is much coarser. There is also a difference. There are about 20 papers that have been reviewed recently talk about the central nervous system. We don't really know exactly what happens, but there are some data indicating that eccentric exercise does use a larger area of the brain when you activate eccentric motions, and you need more time to prepare. There is more central nervous time to prepare an eccentric contraction, but there is certainly a lot of room there to improve. So when we want to use eccentric modalities, we have basically three possibilities to do eccentric exercise. And one I alluded to, this is the drop jump. The drop jump gives you power of larger than 90 watts per kilogram. So this is a very short eccentric action, around 200 milliseconds. You can do a classic strength training, concentric, eccentric, and with a pointer or with electronic devices, you can do an eccentric overload by about 20%. At those angular speeds, you can take about 20% more, and there are devices that do that, and you can then do in an eccentric overload session, you can do like 4 to 6 tons. You can move about 4 to 6 tons during your exercise session. What we have done, and this is what we will discuss in the rest of the talk mostly, is moderate load eccentric exercise, whereby the eccentric exercise is provided by a motor-driven treadmill. So you are sitting on this device and you resist the action of this motor-driven pedal system, and you can control it in a visual feedback system. We do usually do now train with intensity between 100 to 300 watts. We do bouts of four times 5 minutes, 2 to 3 times a week. And we therefore gain, for each of these sessions, we move about 40 to 60 tons of weight. So the actual maximal tension at each stroke is relatively low. It's a moderate load, but it accumulates over time because we usually use 50 to 60 RPMs on this eccentric ergometer. It is evident, it's very clear, that you can't use drop jumps in most cases in rehabilitation, and you probably can't use it in many situations in eccentric overload. You could possibly do it at the end of a rehabilitation period when you have muscle damage or after muscle surgery. Orthopedic patients may be able to do that, but this is not really what I will talk about. It's about this moderate load, continuous load eccentric exercise. So you have two technical implementations which are currently on the market. This is the Cyclus 2 here, and this is the Eccentron. This is circular, and this is a pedal system, and both systems allow you basically to do eccentric exercise in a controlled fashion. And I must say, I must make a disclosure here, I'm involved with both apparatuses. So just that you know, it's just a blurb for actually selling these machines. No. The Cyclus 2 is aimed at the sport population, is relatively easy to use, but is not certified to be used in a patient environment. The Eccentron is fully certified and can be used in a hospital environment, but it is also more difficult to manipulate, and it's not so easy to change settings as it is with this machine, which is really easy to use. Both do their job equally well, I think. Why would you use technical devices? The one thing is you have to be able to reproduce a dosage, because there is no lack of, you don't have a lack of load perception. There's a complete lack of load perception. I can put you on an eccentric ergometer, load you with 100 watts, which is, you don't perceive really, because this is 25 watts concentric, so it's almost no load for you. And I can let you work for 10 minutes. The next day, you will have a massive muscle damage, and you will probably walk down the stairs backwards. So it's, you can induce massive muscle damage using eccentric devices. So you need to be able to dose it, because there is not a load perception. The patient doesn't feel the load that you apply and whether he will have muscle soreness the next day. In a proof of principle study, quite a long time, and this is you will see that again and again in the couple of slides that will come. We had a group of young students who trained concentrically at 120 watt, while their colleagues were working at the same oxygen consumption, same metabolic load eccentrically. And we could show that the group that trained eccentrically had a gain in muscle function, had a larger isometric strength, and they had a larger muscle fiber size. So this was a sort of a proof of principle study. You can do that, and you can gain muscle using these moderate loads eccentric devices. And therefore, and that was the original intent, was use eccentric exercise in diseases with central limitation, coronary disease, cardiovascular disease, and heart insufficiency. But our cardiovascular doctors weren't really happy with this idea, and we had to prove that actually there are no serious consequences of serious eccentric exercise. And so again, we have the same protocol. You have to ramp the intensity on the eccentric exercise. We matched patients, post-infarct patient. We trained them at the same heart rates. These are these bars you see, a bit more of 70%. And concentric patients trained at 100 watts, while the eccentric patients trained just under 400 watts. Their load was just under 400 watts. And what we could show here is that the central blood pressure response, pulmonary artery response, and pulmonary capillary response was similar, almost identical in both training modality. Blood pressure was the same. So basically, from a central cardiovascular point of view, it is safe to apply these training methods. Why would you do it? There is an added benefit, because the group that trained eccentrically, as you can see over here, gained maximal strength over a large range of different contraction velocities, as you can see. And that is something that we have also considered. This has been a recent study coming out. We haven't done anything on COPD, but this is, of course, a possibility, probably not with the type of patients we heard in the first talk, but patients which are better. You see, these are patients working at less than 50 watt concentrically at the same metabolic load and heart rate, and the patients working here close to 150 watts eccentrically. The heart rates are lower for the eccentric training, despite the fact that the mechanical load is much higher. They perceive much less leg fatigue, and the perceived dyspnea is much lower as well. And you can see here again that isometric peak force increased for those who trained eccentrically, also peak force divided by lean muscle mass. And interestingly, and I will come back to that, indications of metabolic adaptations were positive for the concentric, because we know that concentric exercise induces mitochondrial neogenesis, which we don't see here, with eccentric exercise, and I will come back to that. Same problem with sarcopenia, and maybe there is an interesting additional information here, and that is, of course, the risk of falls that increases, and which is a major risk in particular in elderly women. So we used it in a group of elderly with an average age of around 80. There was one group doing cognitive training, just that they had the same exposure in terms of training, classical resistance training, and eccentric exercise. And as you can see here, maximal strength increased significantly for those who did the eccentric exercise. Those were higher, but this didn't reach significance, but probably would have if the number of people would have been lower. Of course, no effect for controls. And interestingly also, lean content increased both with concentric and eccentric exercise. But again, an effect that we have seen many times, and only with eccentric exercise, a relatively massive drop in thigh fat content, but also, and not reported here, in overall whole body fat content. As you can see here, eccentric coordination, the ability to control eccentric power, increases with eccentric exercise, and this has been the only gain that we have been able to ascertain to persist over time. So once you have learned to use an eccentric ergometer, to coordinate an eccentric ergometer, this is something you don't lose later. Whether that has an effect on the risk of falls, we could certainly not tell. Molecular mechanism, and here again is essentially, we find a similar thing that they found more recently looking at COPD patients. We see that there is a gene expression of genes related to remodeling of the interstitial tissue are increased, but gene genes related to metabolism, oxidative metabolism, and mitochondria are decreased. So is mitochondrial density in the muscles that we train eccentrically. But we have also used, and that is a different tack, we have used moderate load eccentric exercise for rehabilitation, classically in ACL, anterior cruciate ligament, as often is a problem in skiing and is in pivoting sports. The main reason is that we can start very early with loading the muscle because we're working a closed chain system and we use moderate loads. And in a paper done by the person who actually did the initial study in the pilot group by Paul Ostaio, you can see that when you do rehabilitate ACLs either with eccentric exercise, as I indicated, moderate load eccentric exercise, then you see that in whether you use a semitendinosus gracilis graft or bone patellar tendon bone graft, the eccentric exercise in both cases gives better results, both on the involved side, black as blue, also in a non-involved side, as compared to the classical ACL rehabilitation procedure. So I would like to come to an end. The summary is eccentric exercise, and I mean moderate load eccentric exercise, has been used to be effective in cardiovascular diseases, has been shown to be applicable in COPD, sarcopenia of old age, and also with rehabilitation in certain settings related to orthopedic surgery, in particular to ACL ruptures and rehabilitation. We do the moderate load eccentric exercise 2 to 3 times per week, 20 minutes, usually broken down now in four times 5 minutes, because we can exercise at the low metabolic requirement for a high mechanical load. So this is one way how we can circumvent a central limitation of metabolism. We can do a strength-type training, but you see the quotes. We can do that with low joint loads and can increase muscle strength and muscle cross-sectional area that way. We can decrease fat content locally and systemic, and there is an increase in eccentric coordination. Again, coordination is not really, is difficult to measure, and it's difficult to assess what it really means and whether that has an implication. What we also know and what is important to retain is that it does decrease oxidative capacity of the trained muscle, and that is not exactly what you would like to have. And I would like to make a last comment here. There are only very, very few studies so far. They have used few subjects, and there is actually not really what you could call evidence. But there is a broad field that is basically open from basic research to application, and I think eccentric exercise needs to be considered in certainly now in a academic environment in rehabilitation. Thank you for your attention.